I feel very honoured to be here. Although I work for the British Council, today I feel even more special because I have an ITEL polo shirt. So I'm an honorary guest member of the team today. So thank you very much. It's been really a fantastic conference. So congratulations to ITEL and to, I'm going to get the name wrong if I said, Universitas Ibu Khaldun Bogor for a fantastic job in putting this amazing conference together. I've learned a lot and I've had a great time at the same time. So, this is the final plenary. I'm going to be not speaking myself for the whole time. I'm going to be joined by some friends of mine in this talk. And I'm going to be speaking for, well, this session is going to be about an hour and 15 minutes in total, okay? So, before I begin, I just want to say that because we're going to be joined by some friends of mine via Zoom, I'm going to turn my laptop around. I'll mainly be standing here, so if you want to fill up, there's still a couple of spaces in this area, but make sure you can see the screen. I might walk over there sometimes. Now, I was thinking, what can I do during this plenary session? You are the experts in digital English language teaching, and I am now becoming an old man. I'm 40, so I'm struggling to keep up with many of the new apps and resources. But I will share with you some of my reflections. I will share with you some of my recommendations for academics in this area. And I'm going to share with you some digital resources as well. I've been in Indonesia twice. This is my second time. And I recently came back to Indonesia. For the last 3 years, I've been working in Palestine. And for the first part of this presentation, I'm going to talk about an innovation in Palestine. It was set up by a charity called the Hands Up Project. Now, the Hands Up Project is run by a man called Nick Cobra, and he wanted to improve the English language skills of children in Gaza and the West Bank. And he couldn't go to Gaza. He couldn't visit the schools. He couldn't train the teachers face to face. So everything he did, he had to do online. So he started connecting with classrooms, talking to teachers, talking to students. And he managed to get lots of volunteer English teachers from around the world to connect with classrooms in Gaza. And about 2 years ago, they set up what they called a remote theatre competition. So in this remote theatre competition, the aim of it, the primary aim of it, was to provide, well, it was a playwriting and play performing competition. It was open to all young people in Palestine, the Ministry of Education at UNWA schools. And it was really to try to encourage, I think in a lot of countries around the world, we know that students in large classes, they're very good at listening and reading, but they're not very good at speaking and writing. So it was really designed to improve their productive skills. So in this competition, there are a number of rules. The play must be 5 minutes in duration. It must be performed by a maximum of 5 actors. For this competition, they had an age limit. But one of the key things about this play is that it is a remote theatre competition. So after they write the play, they have to perform it to camera. They're not performing it to a live audience, they're performing it to a camera, to a screen. So when they do that, in order to enter the competition, they have to make a video recording of the young people acting in the play. So they are performing it to the camera. And then that play is uploaded onto YouTube, and a panel of judges, teachers, drama, teachers, actors, have a criteria to assess the quality of the play for their English, for their performance. They also had to do a script of their play, submit a script of their play, and this year we've also asked them to add subtitles to their video, so an extra challenge. This performance, or this competition, It won a British Council Award for innovation. It's quite difficult to explain how innovative it is. So what I thought I would do, if this works, is I'm going to show you one of the plays. But rather than show you a recording, I'm going to try to connect with some friends of mine. You have to bear with me for this bit.
Kukur-kukur yuk sempet.
Beda kasta apa?
This is Amal, and she is an English teacher in Gaza. So we're now connected with Gaza.
Hi!
Hi.
Hi.
Hi. Okay, everybody can see you now. You're on the big screen. Amal, do you want to introduce what's going to happen next?
Thank you.
Mom, can you hear us?
Yeah.
Okay, so everybody was clapping very loudly. Sorry?
Please. I can hardly hear.
Oh. Maybe it's... I need to change this. You can hardly hear us, yeah?
being engaged and involved in the activities, the drama activities, need you to create a script or create a play. I think it's the dream of every teacher to see those students coming up with their shows and sharing their ideas, sharing their thoughts, and taking a role in a play and be proud of themselves and get the feeling that they are responsible for their learning.
Amal, thank you very much. That was great. I think. Okay, well, I'm going to tell the audience a little bit more about your competition now, and I'm going to share with them the YouTube site.
Can I say something?
Yes, sorry. Yeah?
I just would like to tell you that we have already started a link with a school from Indonesia, and a link from Bogor.
Hello! Parung.
Wow. Well, there are definitely some teachers here from Bogor. Because we are in Bogor.
Schools of the future. It's
very small in here, but it says, the third bullet point in this article, it's important to provide students with the digital skills necessary for the fourth industrial revolution. Again, you can download the whole report is free, and it includes some case studies from Indonesia in this report. Another example, this is a piece of research done by Cambridge University. And in this global education report, I took this quote. It says, as Indonesian students continue their journey as future thinkers, innovators, and leaders, more integration of technology to support their learning will help prepare them to compete in an evolving global market. It's very similar to that quote from the World Education Forum report. So there's growing consensus that in order to prepare students for the jobs, well, the jobs right now and the jobs of the future, that they're going to need, obviously they're going to need good English skills, but they'll also need good digital literacy skills. And so by integrating digital technology into the classroom, you can do both. In the same report, it talks about the competence, actually, of Indonesians in terms of technology. I'd like to tell you that in my experience, more than 4 years in Indonesia, I am so impressed, actually, by the use of technology. It's much, much more advanced than in the UK, than in Europe, than in America. I'm amazed how people can use their phone to do almost anything. We were talking about this last night. You can use it to, you know, to order a taxi with Gojek, or GoFood, or pay your bills. So people are very, very tech savvy. People are very entrepreneurial. There's lots of startup ideas and new businesses. So they have the technical skills, I think. And I think a lot of students, you know, your students are going to be very good with devices. It's now how do you as English teachers take advantage of that and integrate it into the English language classroom? Over to your new Minister of Education, the former CEO of Gojek, a tech entrepreneur. A lot of news articles I read at the moment suggest that, you know, the assumption is that because of the new minister's background, there may well be movement towards, you know, more digital resources, more digital learning platforms, more online courses in certainly the higher education sector, and possibly I think we'll begin to see that in schools as well. This article from the Jakarta Post recently said, higher education in Indonesia, go online or perish. However, there are still some challenges that we need to overcome. I saw this link, and it reminded me, in a session I saw yesterday, it was a separate photo. There is still some resistance to technology in the classroom. People are worried about devices distracting students' attention. Whether, you know, there, I think there are sort of views that laptops or mobile phones are being used for social media or for games and are not being used for learning. So our challenge, and this maybe leads on to the next thing I want to talk about, is how we as practitioners, as academics, need to be able to do research that demonstrates how digital resources can be used positively in the classroom to overcome some of these concerns. So it kind of leads into evidence-based policy making. If the Ministry of Education is going to say technology is allowed in the classroom, is encouraged in the classroom, it needs to be based on evidence. So this kind of is my bit where I'm going to talk to you, especially those of you that are working in universities, those of you that do research, those of you that have been presenting at this conference and maybe presenting at future conferences or want to get published. Obviously, good quality research is the key to forming good policy recommendations. So how can you develop your research skills in this area? There are a couple of free resources. This is a free journal. This is the latest edition. It's called the Language, Learning and Technology Journal. And all of these articles about trends are free. It's free to access, which is great because a lot of journals are not free and they're closed and they're hard to access. Again, so this is the latest, it's February 2020. Another resource, and this one, unfortunately, it's a new book that was published recently. It's on Amazon. It's not free. It's about $10, which is a shame. It's a book around digital innovations and research and language learning. So sometimes, you know, there's a barriers to some of the resources. However, that, you know, with a little bit of exploring the internet, the author of this book, she's a well-known figure in digital English and innovation in ELT. Her name is Sophia Marwidi. She recently spoke at a British Council conference in Mexico, and you can find the whole talk online. It was live, first of all, but it's still online. It's an hour and 10 minutes long. So, you know, her chapter from this book, she covers it in her online talk. It's an hour and 10 minutes, and you can watch the whole thing. So, first of all, my first recommendation is really find and access high quality research in this field of digital and innovation in language learning. Another very good tip, or a site, the way I found out about this and about this was I subscribed to a blog, a really good blog. This is the name of the blog. It's called Adaptive Learning and ELT. And it's really interesting. He's got two posts that he's written recently about technology. Both of these posts are posted this month, February. It just says, more research is needed. And more research is needed into this question. Can technology really enhance language learning? And in his blog, he's being a little bit skeptical, actually, about some of the research in here and in here. He's saying this is a good first step, but in order to answer this question, more research is needed. So it is a bit of a skeptic's view of these resources. So this is how I found out about those resources, by following this blog. And there are, sometimes there are, as well as academic papers, there are meetings around the world. This is a meeting that's going to take place, organized by Cambridge in March. It's a digital learning colloquium, similar in a sense to our ITEL two-day conference. And these are the questions that they're asking. So I think these are the questions we in Indonesia also need to be asking ourselves. Okay, how are we doing for time? It's 3:05. We're doing okay at the moment. How are you doing? You're doing okay? All right. Good. There is going to be a bit more interaction in a moment. I've got four kind of sections to this talk. I should have introduced the sections at the beginning. So the first was a remote theatre competition. Maybe I forgot to say, what I wanted to say about that remote theatre competition is that whilst that was a national competition in Palestine, the concept or the idea, you could easily do that in class, with one class as a competition, or in one school as a competition. It doesn't have to be at a provincial or a national scale. It's an innovation that you can do in the classroom. So I hope that might inspire you to work with your students. And it's quite a straightforward one that certainly has been effective in Palestine. The second part of my talk has been around the importance of research to help the policymakers make of well-informed decisions. The third part of my talk, actually, as I said earlier, is around digital apps and applications, and practical things for you to do. Now, this is something, again, I will confess, as much as I'm trying to keep up, I'm not a tech guru. I'm doing my best, but it's probably because I'm getting older. But I managed to find a real expert. I first met Joe. We're going to meet Joe in a minute in the UK. And Joe is really passionate, like Pajati and many of you, about these kind of new apps, new tools, new resources for teachers to make your lessons more interesting, fun, interactive. So in a moment we're going to meet Joe, and Joe's going to tell you more about some of the, about five or six different resources for you to use. Maybe while I just connect with Joe, because it will take me a few minutes, I'll give you a question. Maybe you can just, in your twos or threes, you can reflect on the competition or on the research, or both, and have a quick chat. And then when we come back, we'll be with Joe. Okay? All right. Thanks.
Jalan-jalan sekarang. Video pun nggak boleh mati soalnya.
Okay.
Melaku-melaku, tekenin di.
I've got a question as we get ready. How many of you, I know you all know Kahoot. So Joe's not going to talk about Kahoot. Well, actually, do you know Kahoot? Do you know Mentimeter? All right, well, we'll see by the end of Joe's talk how many of these you already know and you're expert users, and how many are new, okay? Okay, Joe.
Yes.
When you're ready, I'm gonna put you on screen. Are you ready to go on screen?
Just give me 2 seconds. I'll just share my screen.
Okay.
hoping you can see that full screen.
Not yet. I can, but I'm going to turn off my own PowerPoint and then hopefully we should have you. Yes, we've got you.
Brilliant. Lovely. Well, it's amazing to be here, everyone. Thank you so much for inviting me to take part in this presentation. If I give a quick introduction, if that's okay.
Have you pressed record yet? Because I haven't.
Oh, good point.
All right, so in 5 seconds, you press record, and I'll press record. Oh, we're going to record this, and then later we can share with you the video, okay? All right, so I'll press record, and then we'll do a formal introduction. Ready?
So I press record already. We're recording right now.
Okay, we're recording right now. We'll edit it. So 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Joe, it's all yours.
Brilliant. Okay, so thanks ever so much for that lovely introduction there, Colm. It's a real pleasure to be here, everyone. So thank you so much for taking the time out of the busy programme to come and watch. So my name is Joe Dale. I'm a former language teacher. I taught French for 13 years. 3 years at middle school level. Sorry, 10 years at middle school level. 9 to 13-year-olds on the Isle of Wight, where I still live, and this in the bottom of the UK. And I also taught for 3 years at secondary school level when I first started teaching. And then for the last 10 years, I've been an independent languages consultant, going around the world, running training on the use of technology to enhance language learning. And so obviously when Colm asked me to take part in this conference, I was absolutely delighted. I've been all over the world. I've been to places like Australia, New Zealand, North America, Southeast Asia, the Middle East, Europe, hither and everywhere. And I've met Colm through the ITAF, the conference, which I've been to every year since 2013. So it's a real pleasure to be here, and I very much hope you find this presentation useful. As you can see, it's called Quick Wins with Technology in the Bring Your Own Device Language Classroom. So everything I'll be showing you today will work on all devices apart from the Book Creator web version, which works on tablets or on laptops, on Macs or on PC. So that particular tool will not work on a phone, but aspects around it will. But I'll go through that in more detail during the presentation. I'm going to be doing a lot of live demonstration. I'll be asking for audience participation, so hopefully you've all got your devices with you. You'll see on the slide in front of you that my Twitter handle is @JoeDale. Feel free to follow me on Twitter if you would like to. And my email address is joedale@talk21.com. So let's make a start. Oh, I'm going to share the whole presentation with you as well at the end, so you can have the whole thing as a Google Slides presentation. Right, so. I'm sure you all know that there's the fantastic British Council Learn English website, and I thought it would be useful to use an article from the website in order to show how some of these tools that we're going to be having a look at can work in conjunction with a particular article. So the article that I chose is called Millennials in the Workplace, and just by tapping on the link and going into Safari, you can get it right up on the screen right now. So as you can see, it's called Millennials in the Workplace. If you go to this link, you'll see there are some preparation activities. These are just sort of like drag and drop, which are very straightforward to do to begin with. And then, let me just go back. And then from there, you can then go further down. You've got the article itself about how millennials feel about being in the workplace. You've got some key findings, and you've got some recommendations, and then you've got some tasks. You can see here that there's a discussion question, what's most important for you to be happy at work? So I thought it'd be useful to use the tool called Mentimeter, which I believe some of you have heard about, but maybe not all of you, hopefully. So Mentimeter, as you can see, is a free tool for polling, for surveying students. It's all about getting the opinions of students anonymously, as opposed to other tools which will then mark the work automatically and give feedback in real time, things like Socrative or Cardoot or things like that. So with that in mind, I'm going to open up Mentimeter right now, and I'm going to go to the presentation which I've created for you, which is here. So in a moment, I'll ask everyone with their device, if that's okay, to go to menti.com. Menti.com as opposed to Mentimeter. So Mentimeter is where you create the presentation, and Menti.com is where you go as the delegate or the student to take part in the presentation. So as you can see, I put the question that was in the article, what's most important for you to be happy at work? And if you go to Menti.com, you put in that six-figure code, type of a six-figure code or a five-figure code, in this case it's 688499, then if you put that code into your device on your screen, you can then answer the question, and once you submit your answers, they'll all start to appear on the screen. So this will work in real time, which is great, and you'll be able to see all the answers appearing on the screen, hopefully, in a moment. So I'll just wait a moment to do that. That's okay. And what should happen is all the answers will start appearing on the screen in real time, and it will create a type of mind map. There we are, perfect, excellent. So I can immediately start corresponding and interacting with the answers that come in. So for example, some of you feel that the thing which was most important for you to be happy at work is the use of technology, supporting technology, working as a team, salary, wages, money, these are all synonyms, working with good colleagues, satisfaction, so that's really, really helpful. Seeing students enjoy it, yeah, brilliant, they manage the system, so you see how it's interacting, how it's appearing in real time. I really love Mentimeter, the way in which you can interact while the content is appearing on the screen. So for example, in a language lesson, you could use this as a starter activity to test retrieval practice. In other words, you could say, right, post everything onto the screen that you can remember from the last lesson, or the week before, or the month before. And then you can then test how much the students have recalled the information. Also, you'll see that the word salary, interestingly in this example, has appeared larger than any other words on the diagram, and that's because it's been put in more than other words. So if students are putting the same word maybe too many times, or it's appearing much larger than other words, then that could mean in the language classroom that they're overusing a particular word, for example. So it might mean that it might be an indication that the teacher needs to think about more variety to expose the children to, for example, in the use of a certain verb or a certain adjective. If the children are overusing, or the students are overusing a particular word, that might be indicative of that. So now we can see that now the word team is the most important word in the word cloud, which is great. So hopefully you found that useful. That's really brilliant. I'm loving the way that I just wait for another few seconds, because I think it's amazing to see how it changes in real time. So we've got content such as passion, colleagues, a good boss, holidays. So these are all fantastic for promoting speaking as well. You could be doing all of this in the target language. You could be encouraging the children to give their opinions about the different words that come up. So this is a really great way, I think, of promoting speaking and for gauging opinion and capturing the zeitgeist. So thank you ever so much for all those answers. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to go on to slide two, if that's okay. So from the point of view of the article, we've now captured all that evidence of your opinions about what's most important for you to be happy in the workplace. So from the point of view of using the question from the article, that's a great starting point for doing extra work, be it around speaking or writing or what have you. So thank you so much. So I can see the most popular one now is team. Interesting. Okay, so this is question number two now. So again, I've taken part of the text. I've written the question, the statement, where appropriate, millennials should have the option to work from home. Okay, so now with more and more workers working from home, we have this flexibility now, that it's a possibility. So that's why I've written where appropriate. Obviously, it's not always appropriate to work from home, but where it is appropriate, how much do you agree with this statement? Do you strongly agree with it, agree with it, disagree with it, or strongly disagree with it? So I'll just give you some time now to answer that question. So this could be any question that you want, and you don't have to write strongly agree, disagree, or strongly disagree. I just use that as an example. In a moment I'll show you how to set up one of these, and I used one of the templates that is that appears on the site to give me inspiration about a type of activity that I can do. So this is quite nice, I think. So we can see that most people in the room agree with that statement, and a couple of people disagree. So I would obviously, in a real classroom situation, I would ask the people who disagree with that statement to justify why they disagree with it. So really good for getting opinions out and for justifying opinions. So that's really helpful. Thank you ever so much. And we'll just do the last slide then. Okay, so this is an open-ended question. And you can see, again, based on the article, how can employers increase the job satisfaction of the millennials who are working for them? So in this one, this is one called Speech Bubbles. And what will happen in a moment, once you start answering, if that's okay, is the answers will appear on the screen as if all tiles look a little bit like tweets. And you can also use this as a type of exit ticket. In other words, the students aren't allowed to leave the room until they've answered the question. So, excellent, thank you. So, as you can see, you can write short phrases, you can write individual words. So we've got money coming up twice there. Being innovative, money again, tech-friendly environment. So you can write quite a lot if you want. You can write a couple of short sentences. Make me feel appreciated, absolutely. So you can see here, I can scroll down and I can see all the answers appearing. That's lovely. So I'll give you a few more seconds to finish that off, and then I will then show you how easy it is to have a look at all the answers. So thank you so much for everyone who's replied so far. Excellent. So I can see that salary is coming up a lot, isn't it? Is it just about the salary, or is it about being in a happy workplace? See, again, these are the discussions I think which will be really useful to have, and I think the sort of thing that would create an emotional response in students as well, which I think would be helpful for facilitating their retention of the ideas. Free vacation, that would be nice, wouldn't it? Okay, so as you can see, I'm trying to show in real time how you can interact with all the answers that have come in. So thank you ever so much, all those people that have replied. I'm now going to go to bottom left of the screen. There's a cog there, you'll see. So if you tap on the cog, you can see there are other options that you can have. So for example, if I wanted to have a countdown, I could have a countdown running from anywhere from 10 seconds to 15 minutes. So if it was a discussion I wanted to have, I could maybe go for a few minutes. If it's something that I just want a quick capture of what people are thinking, I might go for, say, 30 seconds or a minute or whatever. You can also change the layout as well. If I tap on layout, I can change from speech bubbles to something else. If I wanted, for example, to generate a word cloud for that last question, then I can do that. And what will happen now, as you can see, that's now generating a word cloud, which again can be used for discussion, for unpicking maybe different keywords around a certain subject, perhaps for writing a text or preparing a speaking presentation. And you've got a few other things such as hide results. If you had someone that was daydreaming, looking out the window, and then just wanted to copy what their friend had written, you could then stop that by hiding the results and then showing them what everyone has answered. So there we are. Those are a few things there which I think are very useful. And now if I tap on the home button, you'll see it looks as if I've done lots and lots of work here, lots of presentations, but actually it's really just a set of core presentations. And what I've done is I've then duplicated the same presentation multiple times. And to duplicate something, all you have to do, I don't know if you can see the two bits of paper that are overlapping, but that's what you do to duplicate a presentation. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to tap here, which is the export results option. And having done that, what will happen is it will generate for free a PDF of all the slides in one file. So you'll see here it is. If I tap on where it says download itel.pdf, you'll see that a PDF will now appear on the screen. There we are, can you see? And if I scroll down, you can see that all the information that you shared very kindly has now all appeared here. So if you're looking for evidence of the work that you've been doing with your students, this is a perfect way of doing that. If I then tap on the arrow backwards, I can also download, for example, an individual image for an individual slide as well. So not only can you have a PDF of all the slides, you can have an image of an individual slide. Yeah. So That's just fantastic. If I wanted to create my own presentation, I would tap where it says your presentation's top left. Actually, before I do that, if I tap on the inspiration option here, you can see that there are all these different templates I was talking about to give you inspiration on how you can use the particular exercise types. You'll see here, there are ones with the cute kittens. These are actually animated GIFs. So if you have a way to create an animated GIF, for example, it's an app called Image Play, I-M-G-P-L-A-Y, very easy to make your own animated GIF, you can put that into Mentimeter, and away you go, creating this sort of thing. So and then if you like the presentation template example, you can just tap Add to My Presentations. So to make your own, you just tap Your Presentations, like this. You tap New Presentation. You put in the title, so just call it ITEL test. You tap create presentation, and then from there, what happens is you can see on the right hand side you've got the different question types. If I tap, for example, on WordCloud, where it says WordCloud, I'm just writing the question, there's a profanity filter available in a number of different languages. You can choose how many answers people submit of the audience. If it's a word cloud, I would say unlimited is fine, but for other ones, such as the last one I showed you, I wouldn't go for unlimited because you'll have too many answers to deal with. And there we are. And then from there, having created the first slide, top left, you tap Add Slide, and you create a second slide, and then the third slide, you tap Add Slide again, it will ask you to put in an email address of a friend. But I know through experience that if you just put in an email address, even if you make it up, for example, mickey@mickeymouse.com, then it will work. It will allow you to have three slides. So for three slides, for free, for plenaries or for staff activities, I think it's a really, really nice tool. And if you've heard about Mentimeter already, then maybe that's going to be a few other ideas, and if you haven't heard about it, I'd really encourage you to have a go at using it in class. I think it's a really fantastic free tool. So thank you so much for everyone's contribution so far. Let's go back to my presentation. Now the next thing I'm going to show you is a tool which I'm hoping that not a lot of people in the room have heard of, which is called shalala.com. And this is a drawing activity which we're going to do. And so I'm going to tap on here, and I'm going to go to the Shalala website. I've already logged in, so I'm just going to go to what's called the draw room, and I'm going to tap where it says start draw room, and there are two exercise types you can do, conversational and game. I'm just going to do the conversational one today, so I'm going to tap on conversational, and then I'm going to tap start, and a little bit like other tools such as Kahoot and Quiz at Live, you can see that on the screen there's a code. So what I would like you to do, please, on your device, is go to shalala.com/draw, and then I'd like you to put in the code 7W88M. If you're using a mobile device, it might say app.shalala.com/draw, as it does on my screen, you can see. And once you put your name in, your name will start to populate on the screen. So I'm going to do it on my another device. I'm going to do exactly that. So I'm just going to put in
7W88M.
There we are. It then asks you for your name. I see raising
the draw, drawing.
Perfect, well done everyone. So I just wait, I'll wait a moment for a few more people to join. And what I will then do for the conversational option is give an audible prompt and ask people to draw something that you've described. So clearly in a languages lesson, this would be a fantastic example on doing the topic of what did you do last weekend. I could say, can you draw a picture of what you did last weekend? And then I and other people can unpick what the drawings refer to. Or if you're doing something more simple, such as physical description, you could draw the hair and eye colour of someone in the room and then get other people in the room to then guess what that's going to be. Or lots of ways you can use this. Anything that turns itself nicely to drawing. And this is perfect. Okay, I can see there's going to be lots of people in the room. I'll just give you another couple of seconds to join the room, and we'll go from there. I'm hoping hardly anyone in the room has heard of this. I'm very excited that I'm showing this to you, because obviously, well, from what Colm told me as well, that there's a lot of people who are very techie in the room. So I'm hoping that you're excited as I am to show you this if you've not seen it before. Okay, I think we're going to go for it now, if that's all right. So on the right-hand side, it says start. So I'm going to tap start. You can still join once I've started, but let's just go for it. So I tap start, and as you can see now, it says listen to your teacher for a drawing prompt. So this is when I can just make up anything I want, and I'll then ask you to draw it. So here we go. I would like you to draw a picture representing how you're feeling right now. So
you're feeling.
Perfect. So I'd like you to draw the picture. I'm going to draw an example on my screen, on my Chromebook screen. So it's not so easy to draw on a laptop. There we are. I'm going to click submit. Having drawn the picture, you click submit. You then click submit again to confirm your submission. Okay. So then having done that, it'll all start to appear on the screen. Perfect. That's really lovely. Thank you so much. So I'll just wait for a moment for you to all draw a picture. So I can see that some of you are sleeping. I can see some of you are happy. I can see some of you are feeling love. Wow, I can see that, is that EN? I can see that someone maybe had a bit, is a bit tired, or maybe, I'm not sure, had a good night last night. Possibly, I don't know. But most of you appear happy, that's all good. So I can immediately gauge how the people in the room are feeling. So let's imagine that there are some of the pictures which I particularly like. So you can see next to each picture, there is a gold circle with a little star in it. If I tap, for example, on this one, then you can see that that's now appearing on my masterpieces board. So let's find some other ones which I can add as well. So this is a lovely one as well. This one's a lovely one. That one as well, a bit of colour there, that's lovely. That one's looking... and if I tap on the picture, as you can see, I can then go full screen and look at the picture. Like that. This one as well. Here we are. So here we are, so you've got one of these. So you can see here, all the ones which I have regarded as masterpieces. In other words, I want to draw out the picture and the language content that can happen as a result of that. Okay, so I'm going to tap End Drawing now. Thank you ever so much for all those people that contributed to their drawings. So if I now tap End Drawing, you'll see, there we are. That if I want to go, I could do a new round, but I'm not going to do a new round. I'm going to tap End Room. And from there, you can see on the right-hand side it says PDF. So if I tap PDF, I can now download all those masterpieces as a PDF. So you can see there it says download storyboard. So if I tap download storyboard, then what will happen is it will generate a PDF. There we are, you see? And obviously I'm on an iPad right now, so I can then export that. If I was on, say, a Chromebook or a Mac or a laptop, I could then export that and keep that as evidence of the work and then use, say, the following lesson. So the amount of language work you can get from the personalised drawings of the students, I think, is just incredible. And I love how simple it is to put together, to generate an activity. And as I said, hopefully that's new to most of you, not all of you, and hopefully you're getting as excited as I am showing you how it works. So let's go back to here. Back to my presentation. So that was Shalala. I'm now going to show you Book Creator for Chrome, which again, probably a lot of you know about, but I'm going to show you some things which hopefully you haven't seen before. So if I tap on the open link again, which should have me logged in automatically. Let's wait and see. I'm logged in already anyway. Right, I'm already logged in, so that's fine. So I'm going to tap on the new book option, and I'm going to tap on the landscape option. Okay, so as you can see, a nice front cover there. And I'm now going to add some content to the front cover, but to do that, I'm going to go to another website, which is called remove.bg, and I'm also going to use a website which is called Photos for Class. Okay? So bear with me. If I go back to Safari now and I go to remove.bg, which is here, this is what it looks like, remove.bg, and this tool does something which I think is absolutely incredible. It does one thing and it does it really, really well. So I'm just going to show you how it works. What you do is you tap upload image, and because I'm on an iPad, I can tap the take photo option. If you're on, say, a laptop or a Mac, what have you, then you'll have to take a photo already or take a photo from somewhere else and then upload it. But with an iPad, you can actually take a picture there and then. If I tap take photo, like this, okay, and I'll take a lovely photo, there we are, and I'm going to smile like this, okay, and tap use photo. And what it's going to do is that, can you see what it's done? It's removed the background automatically so that the only thing that's left is my picture. So this works with human beings, it also works with inanimate objects. So if I were to, for example, now tap download, and tap download, obviously I'm on my iPad right now, so I just downloaded that to my Files app. So if I now tap here, which is my picture, and tap the export option and tap save image, that's now in my camera roll. But if I go back to remove.bg and I tap edit, you can see that if I tap on some of these, I can suddenly change the background to whatever I want. Can you see? So from a language learning point of view, I can put myself in any context that I want, which is quite nice. Well, I'm in outer space now. And I can also tap on the colour option, and I can look as if I'm in some sort of British Council learning website, for example, or an advert, or whatever it might be. I have a long, you know, whatever colour I want. I can also upload my own picture. You can see it says select photo on the screen. I can upload my own picture. But the beauty of Book Creator is the way in which you can then move the pictures around on the screen, whereas I can't move my face there. Now I'm going to show you another website, Photos for Class, which I mentioned a moment ago. So this is photosforclass.com, and I'm going to put in a search for Jakarta. And we'll see what comes up. There we are. So here's some pictures for Jakarta. Now the great thing about photosforclass.com is it's a directory of Creative Commons licensed images, which means that legally you're allowed to use them in class or wherever. But these are designed for use in class. And if I now choose, say, for example, this one, if I tap download and download again, that picture will now download to my device. If I now go to the Files app, and there's the picture full screen, you can see that at the bottom of the picture, in the footer, it has the attribution added automatically to that particular picture. So I can see now the type of license that it has, and I know that legally I'm allowed to use that in my presentation, which is great. So to get that into my camera roll, I just tap the Save Image option. And now I can go back to Book Creator, which is here, and let's go to, there we are. So here's my front cover. This could be on any page I wanted. And to add the content that I've just downloaded and created, I press the plus icon top right, import, and now you can see it says files. So if I tap on the files option and tap photo library and all photos, I can choose my picture. And there's the picture which should now appear. There we are. And from there, I could just have that as it is. I could add some text or a speech model or what have you. But I'm going to add a background as well. So I tap import, files, photo library, all photos, and this time the picture of Jakarta at night time. You can see now that the picture will appear. There we are. The picture now appears over the top of my face. And so what I do is I tap top right the eye icon. I tap on the picture first to select it. And I tap the eye icon, and you can see it says move to back or move to front. So I want to move it to the back. So I tap on that option, and as you can see now, my picture is now there. So in other words, you can use this as a way of creating your own photo story with the students as the actors in their own scene. So this could be a book full of lots of different background pictures that you choose for the rest of the class when you take them in your local area, and you then the students then become the actors in the scene. But to take it one step further, you can then press the plus icon and tap shapes, and you can see that there's a thinking bubble there as well as a speaking bubble. So if I move the thinking bubble, this is interesting. So if the background picture moves, all you do is you just hold your finger down onto the picture, and you can see that one of the options is lock. So I tap the lock option, that means now that this will not move the background picture. Now if I move the speaking bubble to the little green dot next to my head, and then I could write in the speech bubble something like, I wish I was at ITEL 2020, right? And I can make the text a bit bigger if I want to, like this. He says, let's make that text a bit bigger. Should work, let's just do that again. Okay, never mind. I thought, I should be able to do that. Why is that not working? Okay, I'm not sure whether the text might go bigger, but normally that would. Anyway, but now I'm going to tap the plus icon, and I'm going to tap record. Tap allow, and now I'm going to record some audio like this. Here we go. So, I wish I was at ITEL 2020. Then tap use recording, and there we are. Now, if I now put the loudspeaker icon over the top of the thinking bubble, another really nice tip, I think, is having done that, if you tap the eye icon top right, you can see that it says invisible when reading. So I now select that, you can see that the loudspeaker icon is sort of semi-transparent, and if I press the preview button, the play button top right, you can now see that's what the front cover looks like. If I tap on this, I'm hoping you'll be able to hear the audio. Let's see. I wish I was at ITEL 2020. Okay, so again, you can use this as a way of making your own personalised narrated photo story, and the students can record their own voice to say whatever it is appearing in the speech bubbles or the thinking bubbles. So there we are, that's how that works. Another little thing I wanted to show you, if you go on to the next page, is there's a feature which allows you to draw. So if I press on the plus icon, you can see that one of the options is the pen tool. So if I tap on that, you'll see that it says auto. So I tap on auto, and I'm just going to draw something now. Like this. Okay. And I'm hoping that you can see that that is supposed to be a light bulb, but also at the top of the screen there are other icons which have appeared, which the tool is suggesting that my drawing could be. In other words, an ice cream or a skull or a fireplace or a shell or a chef's hat. So using artificial intelligence, this is called Auto Draw, which appears within Book Creator, but originally was a standalone tool, Auto Draw. In fact, let me just come out of this for a second, and I'll show you what I mean. If I go to Chrome, because annoyingly it doesn't work in Safari at the moment with iOS 13 update, but if I go to Chrome and I do a search for Auto Draw, like this, Auto Draw, then it will then come up like this. There we are. If I just do the start over, if I do the same thing again, draw the light bulb, you see the same thing has happened. And if I now tap on this one, it will then appear like this. I could then use the fill tool in order to fill it with a different color, etc., etc., etc. And then to download that picture, I tap on the three lines top left, I tap download, I then hold my finger down on the screen and it says save image, and that's now saved into my camera roll on my device. And that will work for any device that you're using. So AutoDraw works as a standalone tool, but also works within Book Creator. If I now go back to Book Creator, and I press the little X top right, like that. Ah, okay, let me just undo that. Yeah, let me do that again. So, okay, there we are. Right, let me just do that again. If I press the plus icon, pen, auto, draw my picture, like that, choose this one. There we are. So now it's become a nice piece of clip art. Great for grammar practice or vocab practice on simple levels or more complicated levels. You then tap the X here. You can then tap on the paint can option, tap the colour, and then you can then, for example, fill in the any space within a picture which is completely enclosed. So here, having done that, you then tap done. You can then, for example, press the plus icon, press record, allow, start recording, and you can record some audio again. Here we go, like this. This is a light bulb. Okay, so then you tap use recording. You then put the, as we did before, put the loudspeaker icon over the top, make it visible. And by doing that, you can then repeat the same process, and you can make your own type of talking worksheet or talking dictionary in the target language for your students. So if I now press play and press here, it should.
This is a light bulb.
Play the audio like that. Excellent, okay. Right, so the next thing I'm going to have a look at in my presentation is a tool called Wheel of Names, Wheel of Names. Now, if I tap on the link here, and go here, there we are. As you can see, what I've done is I've copied and pasted different recommendations from the original article into Wheel of Names. And if I tap on that right now, what will happen is one of them will then appear, and then as a class, as you can see, you can then have a discussion about that particular recommendation that then has then come up. But on a simple level, if I tap the new option on the left-hand side, you can see that typically this will be used as a name picker. So these could be the students in my class. I can have, I think, up to 200 names in one wheel, but certainly it's fine for a typical class of, say, 30 or 40. So if I then tap on this one, what will happen is it will be, one of the names will be picked out, like this, and you'll see what it feels like that. If you want to get rid of the sounds that come up, what you can do is tap the options option, get rid of the play ticking sound, and then after spin, you can choose to get rid of the play cheer sound and get rid of the confetti as well, and then tap OK. You can also put in the display message that pops up into different languages if you want to as well. If I now tap OK now, that works really nicely. The other thing that you can do is if I quickly copy that link and I push up from the bottom, and this is it on an iPad, what I'm doing is I've actually got the two wheels now side by side. You can do the same thing in, say, Chrome on a laptop, just create a new window and just drag it next to it. So on the left-hand side, I've got all these different names of people, but I could obviously put in subject pronouns if I preferred. But now, if I wanted to, I could put in different verbs, infinitives. So for example, I could use the voice dictation and see if this works. So, watch, new line. Play, new line. Do, new line. Have, new line. Are, new line. Okay. So, I've just put in a few infinitives there. Let's put in this, right, so there we go. To have. So you see what I'm doing. Essentially, the idea is that you then spin both the wheels. That will then generate random sentences, which the students can then come up, or the random verbs, I mean, and then the students can then come up with possible sentences based on the verbs that then appear. So as you can see there, we've now got the names and the verbs. So you'll see that one of these will now come up. What's it going to be? So we've got okay, Ali, and then we've got the verb to play. So we could say Ali plays football every weekend, for example. So that's a simple example, but you could actually create more than two wheels. If it was on, say, Chrome or a laptop, you'd have, say, three or four wheels next to each other with different windows, and that will allow you to generate lots of different chunks of language, which will then allow you to create extended sentences. So that's really nice, I think. The other thing that you can do as well is you can add images. So you can see there on the right-hand side it says add image. If I tap add image and photo library, and tap on the light bulb which I added on before, you can see I've now added a light bulb. So you could use AutoDraw as a way of generating lots of different images which you then put into the wheel of names, and that could be a great prompt for speaking or writing work based on the icons that you put in. And you can save each wheel. If you tap on this chair option and tap continue, each wheel can have its own URL. So you could, for example, create class lists of all your, or wheels for all your classes, and save each one as a separate link, and then bookmark that, or for, say, a lesson whereby you're doing vocabulary or grammar, you can generate the wheels beforehand, and then save the link, and then bring them up when you'd be in the lesson. So if I wanted to, for example, let me just do that again. If I copy the link now, like this, copy link, and then if I then go back into Book Creator and tap go to new page and press the plus icon and import and embed and tap on the embed code option, what I should be able to do, it's going to work. Anyway, what you should be able to do, I've done this many times before, I'm not sure that's not working right now. Anyway, you should be able to embed the link from the wheel of names into the book, but for some reason it's disappearing. Anyway, you just have to believe me, you basically paste the link into where it says embed code and tap confirm web link, and that will then allow you to add the link straight into Book Creator. It's not working right now, I'm not sure where that is. Anyway. So there we are. So let me just come out of this, and I'll just go back to my presentation just to make sure I've covered everything I wanted to cover. Yep, that's all fine. So that's photos for class, which I showed you already, and wheel of names. So just to finish off with, if you go to here, and pages, you can see, yeah, that's all my work there. Let me just get rid of that particular page. If I wanted to then publish my book, I would tap the My Books option, I would then tap on the Share option. I can publish my book online, I can download it as an ebook, I can print it off and turn it into a PDF if I wanted to. If I just tap Publish Online, and call it Itale Example, tap Publish Book, and there it says Publish. And now if I tap Read Online, that's now a unique URL which allows me to look at my book and to access all the multimedia content, including the audio.
I wish I was at ITEL 2020.
And so the idea of this presentation is to show you different ways in which you can use technology tools, free technology tools. Everything I've shown you today is free, in order to promote awful skills, and in this particular example, how to create an ebook, pulling together multimedia assets which you can use for, in this case, promoting intercultural understanding and speaking work. So, to finish off with, I hope you found that useful. Here's the last slide. If you would like to access my presentation, you can do that via the QR code, which I'm hoping everyone can see on the screen, okay? And on the left-hand side, it has the short URL, is.gv/ITEL2020. You can see that my contact details are there, including my email address and my Twitter handle. At the bottom, I've also included a podcast which I do, which is mfltwitteratipodcast.com. There are 10 episodes so far, which are between an hour and an hour and a half, so you can listen to that if you would be interested. Lots of ideas around using technology to enhance language learning, as well as non-techie ideas as well. Drawn from the community of the MFL Twitterati, which is a group of language teachers from the UK and from Thailand and from further afield. And there's 5,000 members, and the idea of the podcast is to celebrate their voices, if you like. So lots of different teachers are sharing their ideas around a particular tool or theme, and then we put it together into a podcast. And as well, if you like this presentation and you'd be interested in inviting me from the UK to Indonesia, or if there are other schools represented here from other countries, then you've got my contact details. I would love to come and do some work in your departments, in your schools, in Indonesia or further afield, if you feel that it would be useful to show you different ways in which you can enhance language learning, or work across the curriculum with these sorts of tools. And I would love to hear from you, and I really sincerely hope you found it useful. And it's given you lots of food for thought on how you use technology in the classroom. And I sincerely hope you enjoy the rest of your day as well. Thank you ever so much for asking me, and over to Colm if there are any questions from the audience, if you have time. Yes, I can hear you fine, yeah.
Fantastic. I'm just going to bring you back so we can see you. And maybe. Thank you very much. So, come see us in the room.
I can see you fine. Can you all wave?
Yeah.
Brilliant. Lovely. Thank you so much for being such a lovely audience. Thank you.
Bye.
She didn't develop those skills in school or at university. They helped, and obviously she got a great bachelor's from Semarang and a fantastic master's from University of Indonesia. But the particular skills that I think has helped her to be successful, to get a job at the British Embassy, to create an online shop in Bali, those skills are skills that she developed outside of formal education system. So I think what is key for me, from this conference, from our work, is helping young people develop these skills, all of these skills, English, digital literacy skills, character, intercultural competence, to enable them to be successful. This is a survey that we at the British Council, we would like to better understand what is happening in digital English language teaching in Indonesia. I'm not asking you to do this now, but if you have time tonight or tomorrow, then please fill in our survey. It's just so we can get a better understanding of your needs and what's happening, some insight. This is our research, and we will share obviously the results of the survey with everybody, so it can help us all to have a better understanding of you know, your expertise, your passion, your interests. And lastly, I want to finish this plenary with two slides, a big takeaway. This is from Pat Jatti's talk this morning. And I think he said one of the main challenges, and actually throughout this plenary, we talked about traditional views and innovation and something new. But one of the main challenges is to find the right balance between the time-honored teaching practices that have been handed down for centuries, good pedagogy, and new possibilities afforded by, in this case, AI. And it was interesting when I saw this slide, because when I was walking around this hotel, I found a similar sign. And I don't know if you've seen this sign, but this is obviously the right hotel for this conference, because downstairs is this sign on the wall, where historical values and modern technology meets. So, I thought that was an amazing coincidence. I don't think they put it up just for us. All right, so apologies for going over time and for any problems with the technical connections. Thank you very much for your patience. I'll share all of the slides. And thank you again to Agati and the team for a great conference over the last 2 days. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Downsnow. We will have a very brief question and answer session. We only have maximum 5 places for question and answer. Okay, this one, Ibu here. Ibu, you have